Hello students, I am A.K. Mishra, founder and chairman of Chanakya Ice Academy. I welcome you to this program, Success Speaks. As you know, in every program, every episode, I introduce you to one successful candidate who has a very different kind of success story. In this episode also, I am going to introduce you to Rashmi. Rashmi has got All India 216 rank in Civil Service Examination 2018, and now she has been allocated IPS, Indian Police Service. So this has been a very interesting journey. This was her fifth attempt. She, in the earlier attempts, in first, second and third attempt, she could not qualify pre, although she was a serious student, but why she could not make it, you will be able to understand from her better. In her fourth and attempt, she went up to interview. She could not make there in the final interview. And finally, in the fifth attempt, she got Indian Police Service. So welcome, Rashmi, to this program. Congratulations, Rashmi. You have got Indian Police Service now finally in your fifth attempt. How are you feeling?
So feeling is of relief and happiness, of course. So
the word relief, when you say, this is really very interesting. Yes. How it has been painful or it was a challenging journey? How did you see all through your 5 years?
So it was definitely challenging and did become painful at times, especially when I reached the interview level and I did not get in. So because a lot of expectations get attached when you're each phase of this exam, each time you attempt the exam, it's almost 2 years. So after the journey, if you can't, don't make it. So it becomes very painful at that time because you keep castigating yourself, what went wrong and what more you could have done. So that way, I would say that it's painful as well as challenging. Both.
This is the beauty of this, bearing this pain ultimately to get a final result. Of course, we'll discuss all your journey, but let me know something about your background, your family background. Okay, who are your parents? What has been your background?
So I come from a defense background. My father was in the army. He was a colonel, doctor, 10 years ago almost, I think when I was in second year college, I lost him in a militant attack.
Achha, where it happened all there?
He was posted in Arunachal and as a commanding officer in a medical unit.
Medical unit. Mm.
And he was on his way from Assam to Arunachal at that time. He was ambushed by Bodo militants in Assam. So this happened when I was in second year of my college.
Okay, this must have been a very tough time for the family. Who else are in the family?
My mother is there, she's a homemaker. And my brother is also in the army now. He's part of the dental corps in the army.
Okay.
My brother is married also to another AMC officer. Okay, now, recently he married.
So, all the army background.
Yes.
Now, you're going in police service here, in civil line, right?
Yes, sir.
So, it must have been a very tough time, how the family came out and what was your psychological condition, because you were quite young that time.
Yes, sir. So, that time it was, of course, very shocking, and suddenly life changed totally. Our life changed totally, because before that we were part of the like every 2 years, 3 years we'll be moving to different parts, and right. It was suddenly we moved to Hyderabad permanently after that. And
that's your native place, Hyderabad, is your name?
So we relocated there. My mom is from that place, so just shifted to that area. My dad is originally from AP, Andhra Pradesh. So earlier it was one state only, so there was
right. So earlier you were moving from one state to other state, it could have been there, but how this idea of civil services came in your mind?
Yes, so I was always fascinated with civil services since my school days. My mother is the one who actually motivated me towards, I was a good student academically, so she used to say, you know, you should try for civil services. So from there the idea took root. Later on, when I lost my father, I took it seriously then. Because in my continuous interaction with government departments at that time, I was motivated to join the service, because we keep complaining about how government officials don't function properly. But I wanted to be part of the system, because once you're in it, then only you know what actual problems are there and how you can improve on them. So my real motivation came from there.
While interacting with the civil servants in that time around, you could feel that even you can contribute to the system by being a part of that. Then what happened? You did your graduation in law.
Yes, sir.
And you joined some corporate organization also.
Yes, sir. Yes.
But when it comes to the first, second, third attempt, you could not make in the pre.
Yes, sir.
So what do you think could have been the reason of not getting success there?
So my first attempt, I did not prepare at all from the serious point of view. Like, I didn't read any newspaper. I just read some magazines. I was not very serious about it. I just gave it in a lighthearted way. So that was a mistake. Same goes for the second. For my third attempt, I moved to Delhi to take coaching and all. I missed, narrowly missed prelims by a mark. So what I realized was that I'm not very good at objective kind of paper solving, because that required a lot of preparation on my part, trying to, in a time-bound manner, trying to get the right answer. There are a lot of techniques to get to score high in MCQ kind of questions.
So let's discuss here first, while you're talking about preliminary examination, although you say you are very good in writing and communication skill. Yeah. But to be sure, because that is with large number of students appear, and that is just a screening test for this examination. Yes. If you don't cross it,
yes,
you are nowhere.
Yes.
So what do you suggest to the students, future students, how seriously they should take, how they should make their strategy,
yes,
which could help them to really ensure their success in preliminary examination?
Yes. So first thing I would say, they should start at least 8 to 9 months, if time permits, at least a year before the preliminary exam that you take. And it will be better if you're not working at that time. You should, full time, you should dedicate to that. Of course, part time also you can do that, but I would suggest full time. And in that, you should first start off with going through thoroughly reading the syllabus, because that will give you a great idea of how, what you should expect from the exam itself.
So the first step is to get a thorough understanding what has been prescribed in the syllabus.
Yes.
Should go in the mind very clearly, right?
So because the syllabus is so vast that and the topics are so general in nature that you can easily get branched out into areas of knowledge rather than exam-oriented learning. So for that, I would say thoroughly read the syllabus and then have form an approach for prelims separately and mains separately. Because for mains, you need answer writing practice. While for prelims, you need to practice the question solving thing. Here, I think it will help engineering students more, since they have already written several exams to earlier. But for other people from art streams, I think it's better to solve at least 50 to 60 test papers,
mm-hmm,
because that will give you, and in time-bound manner. So it will tell you how much time you take to actually solve a question and how to get the right answer or when you're stuck between two choices.
But so, in the preliminary exams, there are a lot of things to read,
yes,
right?
Yes,
and so how do you make it possible, concise, so they become really doable?
Yes, of course. For preliminary, particularly, there are subjects like history, geography. So you should pick out each subject and have at least not more than two books for each subject, and then totally thoroughly read the newspaper. You should, because current affairs forms a major part of prelims these days. It varies from year to year, but current affairs forms a major part. So if you're thorough with your newspaper, your current affairs will be done.
Now, this is a very interesting topic you are talking about, the study of the newspaper,
yes,
right? That is also a big question, because many of the students just keep reading the newspaper 5-6 hours, and they don't know what to gather out of that.
Yes.
Whereas the most practical way to get hold of newspaper reading should be ideally not more than 1 hour, 1.5 hours.
Yes.
So what do you suggest? What should we focus on? How to make a relevant study of newspaper and how to internalize it?
Yes, so I would say first you should divide, like for if you're giving 1.5 hours, you should first give 45 minutes to read, for reading the newspaper only, and then 45 minutes for writing the essential points. It can vary according to one's speed and reading speed and writing speed. When you do that in a time-bound manner, you will be focusing only on the relevant things.
Delight.
If you say that, okay, I'll sit down and start reading.
This word relevant is very important.
Yes.
How to be clear that what is relevant for an IAS aspirant in the newspaper? What do you say for that?
So sections like the first page and the editorial page, and I would say the economics page, which is there, economic news, which is there. These three, I think, are more than sufficient. If a person reads these three thoroughly, it's more than sufficient, I think.
So the first page, the editorial page, and maybe some specialized pages,
yes,
which are coming. Did you make some notes out of reading newspaper, or you just had to remember the things?
No, so I think the best, or you should not leave anything to memory when it comes to this exam, because the time is too long between exams. So you should immediately, as soon as anything which is, seems relevant, it should be noted down. because then you can't go back to the newspaper again, but you can always refer to your.
But a lot of things appear in the newspaper, so how can you make notes of everything?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So I think you should refer to your person should refer to the previous year's papers.
Previous year papers and also the syllabus. Okay, what is relevant if any issue has emerged in the coming time, which will be building up, or some problems.
Especially for prelims, it is more important to read the previous year's papers. Because then you can get a better idea, for example, GI tag related questions or animal discoveries or plant discoveries. These kind of questions keep coming, recurring every year. So whenever you read the newspaper and something like this comes up, you can immediately make a note of it. So it will stay with you.
Rashmi, the whole study, where from to begin, what to begin, that's of course always the practical suggestion is to begin from the NCERT books, yes. Right? So what do you suggest for the NCERT book? Because many students have confusion whether they should read the old NCERT books or they should read the new ones, or they should start from 6th standard or 9th standard or 11th. So that's a dilemma always in the mind of students who do not have right guidance. Yes. The idea of this program is also to demystify a lot of things there. Yes. So just suggest your opinion on that.
So ideally, I would say 6th to 12th NCERT for subjects like history, geography, polity, this should do. But there are a lot of repeat, the material is repeated a lot, say 6th, 7th, 8th, and then the same is repeated in 9th, 10th, and then same is repeated. So I think first a person should have a general reading of all the NCERTs, mm-hmm. and then only pick out the points which are seem relevant to the exam. Because before the exam, reading all the NCERTs all over again won't be possible.
You're right, right.
And for especially for subjects like history, I think only 11th, 12th, if you're thorough with 11th, 12th.
That will take care
that
of.
Will old, like I refer to old NCERT because I like the storytelling form of the old NCERT. Some other person might prefer the new one. So it is better to have a thorough reading in say 10 days. You can, NCERTs are very thin books, so you don't.
So the idea here is that one should first go through the syllabus, see the previous year questions and then decide the strategy. Then one can also always assess how much one person is familiar or candidate is familiar with the subject. If you have a background of that subject, you can start from the higher level also. If you don't have background, then to get hold of the fundamental, start from even the 6th if it is required. But did you prepare some notes also while reading the NCERT book?
Yes, sir, definitely. Like I said, going back and reading all the NCERTs again won't be it will be time consuming and won't be possible also, and it will give you more stress. So I would like say 6th, 7th, 8th, I made notes out of them. Since the books are very thin also, so you don't need, there is not too much material for your prelims or mains. So I just made the relevant points, any points which can come as an MCQ. I just made notes of that. And
let's subject wise, like history.
Yes, sir.
Of India, and also in the mains you have the history of the world. So how did you manage this? Did you read all through only the NCERT book, or you added some value out of some other reference books?
Yes, so for NCERT, for history particularly, I did only 11th, 12th old NCERT, main. I mainly focused that for prelims also and for mains also. Well, international history, there's 9th and 10th NCERT is there, which covers a lot of aspects of international history. Mm-hmm. For rest, I used internet because international history is very vast. So I used the, referred to the syllabus and followed the topics according
from
to the
net,
timeline provided in this.
You downloaded and read from the internet.
Yes, sir. And I made notes out of that. So, because the international history is also quite vast. So, I just made notes out of what kind of questions come and then
proceeded. For the future aspirants, it should be clear.
Yes, sir.
That it's a very one-to-one candidate's basis. Mm-hmm. One should know the strength. And you should not just jump into voluminous books to read and complete that. You should be checking now the syllabus, question papers, and then pick up some standard books and keep adding as per the need of that. That is the thing we want to suggest. This is wonderful. Now let's talk about the preparation. Do you suggest a pre and main separate preparation, or you want integrated preparation for both?
So I would say the strategy which you adopt for pre and main should be different, but the subjects are same. So when you're reading it, you are you will be reading it for both. But when you are, see, if you're making notes, then you should make a separate notes for mains and for prelims.
This is very interesting. So the first part is that it should be integrated reading for both of something,
yes,
but keeping in mind the previous year questions,
yes,
for pre and mains, you can make separate points and notes for that. So when you're talking about separate,
hello friends, my name is Dilip Pratap Singh Shekhawat. I have secured all India rank 72 in this year's civil services examination 2018. And now I am here to share my experiences of the mock interview for UPSC. So I would like to mention the role of Chanakya IAS Academy. The mock interview which I gave at the Chanakya IAS Academy was very helpful for me. It was the last mock interview which I gave before the actual interview of UPSC, and it really helped me to gain that confidence level back. because I was facing a very low, because my final interview, mock interview, didn't go really well, because I was facing problems, like I was nervous before the interview, and hence I went to Chanakya IAS Academy, gave a mock interview there, and the board was very professional. It was very cordial. They asked me all the questions related to my bio data. They assessed my personality in a very nice manner and boosted my confidence in the right time.
What is the basic fundamental difference in the whole approach for pre-inmates?
So for example, for pre's, you can, supposing you're reading a history NCRT, when you're writing notes for the prelims exam, so you can just note down, you can just note down small points which can come as an MCQ. If you refer to the older newspapers, you will see some names or some titles of older officials. These are the kind of questions which come for history.
Correct.
So you can just write down in a piece of paper, in a separate notebook, that this is for prelims. For mains, you need longer analysis and analytical kind of answer, analytical kind of notes. So in that, you can write pros, cons, that kind of elongated answers, which you can, or points which you can elaborate later on. So that kind of approach.
So according to you, while reading, like it is history or polity, anything, one should keep the facts and figures which are required for pre and do practice on that, but at the same time to develop analysis and opinion for the mains point of view. So if it goes simultaneously, it will be of bigger help,
yes, sir,
to the candidates, right? That's very interesting. Time management is a very crucial thing in the whole exam. Some people, if they don't know, they will think that they have to read for 15, 16 hours, something like that. What has been your average of hours of working? You were in job also for quite some time.
Yes. So I would say aiming at 10 hours a day is more than enough. It can vary. It can vary to 8, 6. But if you are regular,
Impressivity is going to be around 6 to 8 hours. Uh-huh. That will also take care of that.
Yes, sir. But main thing is to finish. I think it's like if weekly agenda, if you manage to finish your weekly agenda earlier on also. So then that is also
efficient, fun. Effective approach, and also to meet with the targets.
Yes.
And the target which is doable,
yes,
not that abnormal target, you make it and every day you fail.
Yes, sir. Instead of counting the hours, it's better to see how much portion you've completed. So that is a better approach, I think.
And the target we should be doable.
Yes.
Not that it is going to be abnormal.
Yes.
And every day you have the backlogs. Yes. So that won't be good for that all there. And how to manage stress, because stress management is very, very important.
Yes.
In this exam. Did you have some any hobbies also you practiced?
So hobbies per se, not so much, since my hobby is also reading reading books only. I used to watch some TV programs or some web series. I just go for a walk if I'm feeling too much pressure on the brain. I'll just go for a walk. I did not dwell too much on
By and large, you would have relaxing time walking,
yes,
maybe watching some program,
yes, sir,
and you could concentrate more on the reading part itself,
yes, sir.
And when it is a question of managing stress, I told you again. So because you must be feeling sometimes very low, whether I can do it or I cannot do it.
Yes.
So what motivated you and kept you back on the track?
So like I said, my experience from what I learned from my father, and my mom also constantly motivated me that, you know, I can do this, this is my dream is. So I kept thinking back, what is my why for writing this exam? Whenever I felt demotivated, I would think why actually I chose this to get into this exam thing. So after, whenever I used to think that, I used to again get back on track.
It means you had a clarity of your goal and you had answer for why.
So the reason why I'm actually writing this
exam,
if this is certain, then there's no need for external.
Why is always giving a drive to a candidate there. Let's talk for some time about main examination. On the whole, the strategy, of course, writing skill is important. Other thing, but if we talk specifically about a paper like ethics and integrity aptitude, which is paper 4 of gender studies, so what is the nature of the paper? What exactly examiner wants to see in this paper?
So I think the examiner basically wants you to write realistic solutions, not too idealistic and not overly practical. He wants you to write something which will connect with the people,
mm-hmm,
like empathize with the people. That is the main aim of the ethics paper, is that to see how much you can actually understand the people's problems, mm-hmm, from their perspective, not from your perspective. So that kind of a realistic solution they seek for most of the problems, and they expect you to real life solution, real life examples also. Like if any question is asked regarding any moral dilemma, they would expect you to answer it in your own personal experience also. They usually frame the question in such a way.
After all, this is a test of your whole personality,
yeah,
how as a civil servant, mm-hmm, you will be practicing and ethics, integrity and aptitude in your practical life.
Yes.
Would you like to define a bit this T3 words, ethics, integrity and aptitude?
From the exam perspective, I would say that ethics is something which is very general. It is like value oriented, while integrity is something which is personal. Ethics is something which is something which is expected out of people. Well, integrity is it is natural. Well, aptitude, it will tell you what kind of job are you actually fit for, in other words,
you can say ethics. There may be different kind of social ethics,
yes,
political ethics,
yes, other public ethics and private organizational ethics.
Could be a lot of things,
yes,
but
sir.
How to remain effective, efficient,
yes, sir,
and to abide by the system as per the directions of the constitution of the country and the law of the country, and still did how to maintain ethical values at the same time to maintain also the efficiency of the job. That is the dilemma.
Yes.
Integrity, I think you be able to tell that. Integrity with the job, the profile in which you are going to be there. So how you are going to maintain integrity with the job, right? And the, you still maintain the character for that, right?
Yes.
Is it clear then? And what about the aptitude?
So aptitude, I think, is more about the skills, like what kind
leadership
of
leadership skill,
yes,
time management,
skill,
emotional management,
yes,
different traits,
EQ, IQ, all everything is included in aptitude.
Problem
basically,
solving
how much
attitude.
Are you fit for the service that you're choosing
as per the requirement?
Yes,
right, that's it. So now, regarding the case studies, what did you do for the case studies, and which you would like to suggest?
So solving as many case studies as possible is one good approach towards this. Because no matter how many, main thing is that you should expect the kind of answer that, like, some kind of a skeletal answer you should already always have in your mind from the exam perspective, because there was not much time to think like what kind of answer you want to present. Of course, you can change the details depending on what kind of question is asked,
sure,
but the basic format of the answer should be the same. There you will save time and you can write the answer in a much better way, which is more pleasing to the examiner also.
Now, overall, to conclude, what three basic qualities you would like to suggest in a success-oriented candidate who wants to qualify in this exam?
So, three qualities I would say. First, of course, a positive mindset is very important. Second is discipline, because this exam requires long hours of studying and then self-introspection and everything. Third, I would say is keeping your reason why you actually want to write this exam. It should always be foremost. You should write it down, and if you can't remember it, you should put it somewhere on the wall where you're actually studying. These
so
three things, I would say, would make all the
always
difference.
Keep you motivated.
Yes, motivation is, it will keep you motivated throughout this.
Thank you very much, Rashmi. I hope
thank you, sir.
This will help many of the future aspirants to also take a lot of inputs and inspiration from you. Wish you all the best and a great career in the Indian Police Service.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Don't forget to like, share and subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update.